legend has it that two young fingerling fish, full of a spirit of adventure, were enjoying an early morning swim beneath the waves when they happened upon a much larger, older fish. "Excuse me, ma'am," said the more polite fish of the pair. "We want to swim in the ocean, and wondered if you could point the way for us." The older fish hovered in place and eyed the two youngster fish and smiled. "Why," she said, "I'm pleased to tell you that you are in the ocean." The second fish thanked her, and the pair swam away slowly. "She must be senile," said the first fish to his companion. "Poor thing. Everyone knows this is only water." Disappointed, they swam on. On July 9th, 2017, in Indianapolis, Indiana, the Reverend Teresa Hord Owens, an amazingly qualified and gifted person, said yes to a call extended to her by the General Assembly of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ in the United States and Canada, and Terry will lead our movement for wholeness in a fragmented world as our new General Minister and President. She is the first African-American woman to ever be elected to lead a Protestant mainline denomination in the United States and Canada. That's huge. Thank you, God, how far we have come, and yet how far we have yet to go until systemic racism is a historic rather than a contemporary reality. By the close of her installation service, we knew why General Minister and President Reverend Terry Hord Owens chose John, the 17th chapter, as a focus for her leadership among us. Her favorite line from Jesus' prayer for unity is verse 21. "I pray that they will be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. I pray that they also will be in us, so that the world will believe that you sent me." Think about that. Our witness, our example, all the ways in which we demonstrate love for God and neighbor, either confirm or deny to everyone around us that Jesus was sent by God. We can understand that. If we've ever enjoyed the privilege of helping to equip young disciples of Jesus, how rewarding is it when they come back to us as adults and tell us all about how they're growing their faith and all the wonderful things they're doing to love God and neighbor. Disciples of Christ in Greater Kansas City, can we drop whatever cynicism or disappointments or limiting attitudes we may have picked up over the years and realize in our context what those two little fish could not in theirs? We are doing well. The church is not dying. It is morphing. And it has to. This is not our first rodeo. The church has refocused its work and redesigned its structures and reconnected, revitalized the faith community that God has called together for each time and place in the history of the church, and now is no different. Folks, the promised land we know is not a manicured garden and luxury condo community out there someday after we die, and the kingdom of God is not hidden in that afterlife. And while we may indeed understand it better by and by, but Jesus has already told us enough, and we've already seen the signs to become more profoundly aware today that God is at work in the world, and we have the privilege of working alongside God. And things are getting better. We sing, "We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord," and we do in fact pray that all unity may one day be restored. And as we proclaim and pray that, our feet are already moving, our hands are working, our eyes are focused, and our minds are comprehending that we are already in the kingdom of God. Let us resolve then to act like we know somebody. Let us behave more as if the one we claim as Savior and Lord was walking, teaching, and leading among us. And let's get to know and appreciate our new General Minister and President. See the video at the kcdisciples.org website. Take in the fact that this year we made history together, and this is just one in a series of historic steps taken by the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. We are part of an amazing movement. And yes, we are members of a church that is perfectly poised to help new generations of seekers to form new communities of faith in new ways, telling the old, old story in ways most of us who've been cradle Christians can't imagine. But can you think of a better legacy than to leave our children and grandchildren with a deeper faith and a stronger, more resilient and responsive church? Yes, I know we disciples, even in our oneness, never all... Yes, I know that we disciples, even in our oneness, never all agree about the number of the essentials of the Christian faith. We espouse differing viewpoints about the practice of religion. We argue about politics and the use or misuse of power and wealth, our own and those of others. But each Lord's Day, we still gather at the table those who just don't get us at all, with those whose interpretation of the Bible we agree with, and with those who see and live it differently. And we gather at the table, we break bread and drink from the cup, because Jesus told us to do that together. Yes, we will work with each other in mission and ministry, and as disagreeable as we may be with each other sometimes, we will guard each disciple's dignity and save each disciple's pride, so that the world will know, so that the world will see that indeed Christ was sent, that God so loved the world, still loves the world, and desires that we all continue to do justice, embody kindness, and walk even further along humbly with God into God's preferred future. Please join me now in a short prayer. God, whenever we pause to notice what you're doing in the world, we are astounded. What seems to some ordinary or routine can suddenly take on beauty and importance we had missed. Help us to recognize what you've already provided for us, for the church, in this time and place, where we live, lead, and serve. There's so much that you want to still fix, repair, heal, and we ask you to continue to include us in that holy work for stronger faith, for deeper hope, and more love to join with Jesus already at work within, among, and around us. And we ask this in Jesus' name.